The RX7900XT, which launched at a pretty steep price of $900, was at the time and even now only a few hundred dollars cheaper than the 4080 at MSRP. While it was marketed along with its One Extra X brother as the most advanced graphics for gamers and creators, utilizing AMD's long-awaited Navi 31 chiplet architecture, its performance didn't live up to that dream. But do you know what is a dream? Our sponsor, Skillshare. Skillshare is a wonderful online learning platform that lets you learn whatever you want, whenever you want. From growing your business portfolio to photography, you name it, Skillshare's got it. I myself am brushing up on my photography skills using Jeremy Murray's Photoshop Masterclass for aspiring graphic designers. Learn how to get an entire month of Skillshare for free by using the link in the description below. Now, I'm not going to bore you with the specs, as it's a long list of things you probably don't care about. I'll tell you the basics. The 7900XT uses TSMC's 5nm process node for the GCD, or graphics compute die, while using an older 6nm process, again from TSMC, for the memory cache die. It also uses 5376 cores, admittedly 38% fewer than the 3080, 336 TMUs, 192 ROPs, and 20GB of GDDR6 on a 320-bit bus. Additionally, it boasts a clock speed of 1500MHz to 2394MHz, and a memory clock of 2500MHz. On paper, these are pretty good specs. Keep in mind, however, that the 3080 is the only card we can probably compare to this one. We do have other cards that we ended up testing, but due to the channel not being large enough for even Nvidia to acknowledge its existence, let alone send us cards, this is all we have for today. Make sure to get subscribed, however, as we are working on brand new content that will surely excite you. Getting straight into the rasterization performance, first with F1 2022, 4K maxed out, we see the 7900XT pull a healthy lead of around 43% in average frames over our 3080. While at 1440p, the gap shortened as we become more CPU bound, leading by around 34%, and finally at 1080p, it achieved 24% higher average FPS. The 7900XT takes an early lead, but as we progress through the games and into ray tracing performance, you'll notice its flaws, even against the 3080. In Hitman 3 at 4K, we see a 36% performance advantage over the 3080, while at 1440p, we only see a 22% performance advantage. And finally at 1080p, we see little performance difference between these cards, achieving an interestingly small 14% performance difference. Next, in Cyberpunk 2077 4K Ultra HD, we see a 38% performance increase over the 3080, but it's hardly anything to ever notice, with 10 more FPS. However, the gap significantly widens, with the 7900XT producing 52% higher performance at 1440p, and again producing a healthy lead of around 52% at 1080p. It's interesting how the gap between these cards wasn't huge at 4K, but then at 1440p and 1080p, the gap widened dramatically, becoming less GPU bound from 1440p to 1080p. This could be an example of the drivers not allowing the full potential of this card, but I did make sure to have the latest drivers before testing at the time, and they have improved massively since launch, so I'm not sure why something like this would occur. It goes to show that even though the drivers have been somewhat improved, the performance still isn't quite tame yet with these new cards, despite them being out for months now. In Spider-Man Remastered though, things start to get even more interesting. While at 4K, the 7900XT still manages to pull ahead of the 38 by 32%. Even at 1440, it manages a lead of 19%. However, 1080p, for the first time, the 3080 pulls ahead of the 7900XT by well around 1%, but a loss is a loss, and I don't think this is an example of becoming more CPU limited, as the 3080 outperforms it even in 1% loads by around 6 FPS, ignoring the 0.1% loads as they seem to vary a lot in our testing, specifically in Spider-Man. Next, in Shadow of the Tomb Raider, again completely maxed out at 4K, the 7900XT manages another lead of 29% over the 3080, while at 1440p, it beats it by around 37%. And lastly, at 1080p, it outperforms it by 33%. Interestingly, we are seeing a similar situation to what we observed in Cyberpunk 2077, but slightly different, as the gap decreases once again, going from 1440p to 1080p. In Red Dead Redemption 2 4K maxed out, we see a meager performance increase on the 7900XT, with about 11 more average FPS, or about a 23% increase versus the 3080. Moreover, moving over to 1440p, we see the gap widen with the 7900XT, with a whopping 40% increase in average frames, or an actual noticeable performance increase. While finally at 1080p, we observed another big increase of 47% in average frame rate. Moving over to Forza Horizon 5, now again in 4K, we see the 7900XT slightly outperforming the 3080 by 28% in average FPS, with that gap steadily decreasing, going down to just a 20% increase at 1440p. 1440p, where finally it smooths out an 18% increase in average frames. Grand Theft Auto 5, all maxed out at 4K, shows a 2% increase in average frames, while remaining the same at 1440p, with another 2% improvement versus the 3080. And finally at 1080p, we see a 3% increase in performance with the 7900 XT. It's interesting to see the performance gap widen at 1080p, which is the opposite of what we saw with Cyberpunk. However, things kick up a notch once again, Rainbow Six Siege, where at 4K max settings, the 7900 XT pulls ahead by 27%, and 1440p starts steadily increasing to 33% higher frames than the 3080, while once again in 1080p shifting back down to a 32% increase. This unusual behavior could be the margin of error, although it's too hard to conclude. As I said, the drivers still seem to be a bit muddled at this point, even with recent improvements. In CSGO, it truly becomes interesting, as at 4K maxed out, the 7900 XT loses to the 3080 by 9%, which took me by surprise. While at 1440p, that story doesn't seem to continue, as the 7900 XT pulls ahead by 7% versus the 3080. While at 1080p, we again see a similar situation to 4K, where the 7900 XT once again loses by around 8%. Now, to summarize all 10 games at 4K on average, the difference between these cards is overall pretty small, with the 7900 XT outpacing the 3080 by only a measly 17%, while at 1440p, the 7900 XT ends up being only 22% better, and lastly at 1080p, interestingly, the average FPS ends up only being 15% higher than the 3080, which brings to light the behavior that we saw early in some of the games like Cyberpunk. Moreover, it helps to digest the point made in the title of the video, and that the performance difference between these cards is not huge, and it is so small you will not be able to tell the difference side by side without seeing an FPS counter, which is disappointing considering how the 3080 is a last gen card from Nvidia. This is further backed up from a price standpoint as we look at the performance per dollar graphs. Now keep in mind that the prices of these cards will always fluctuate, but what doesn't genuinely change is the performance, unless there is a driver update that improves performance. So if you want to recalculate the performance per dollar, take the average performance seen in our average FPS chart for each card and divide it by its current price. Now at 4K, these cards are extremely close, with a 7% lead on the 7900 XT, while at 1440p, the 7900 XT leads by around 9%. And lastly, at 1080p, it drops to only a meager 3% higher performance per dollar than the 3080. You probably won't be playing at games at 1080p, however, with these cards. Onto the average power consumption now, at 4K, we see the 7900 XT pulling up to 12% more power, while at 1440p, it drops a bit to 9% more power than the 3080. And finally, at 1080p, it draws around 8% more power. Moving on to performance per watt, or average FPS per watt, we see that the 7900 XT is slightly more power efficient than the 3080 at 4K, with a meager 6% difference. While at 1440p, it increases to around 11% more performance per watt. And finally, at 1080p, that number drops to only 6%. These comparisons help to highlight once again the point made in the title of the video. The 7900 XT is just barely better than the 3080. It's not a difference that you would generally even notice while gaming, and it's not even much more efficient than the 3080, despite having a much more cutting-edge process node. If I had some newer 40 series cards to test, like a 4070 Ti, a card that is still actually cheaper than the 7900 XT, you would have known just how boring and uninspiring this card is, and what other reviews don't actually show you. Moving along now for ray tracing games. In our 10 games, 5 of them happen to support ray tracing, so we'll use them here for simplicity's sake, and also so you can compare the card's performance with or without ray tracing. Starting with Cyberpunk 2077 on 4K maximum settings for ray tracing, we see the 7900 XT lose to the 3080 by 6%, while at 1440p, we see that gap widen with the 7900 XT again losing by 11% in average frames. And lastly, at 1080p, it again loses by 10%. This was as expected. As you probably know, ray tracing is Nvidia's jam, but it's pretty disappointing to see the 7900 XT lose by this much. Moving on to F122 4K ray tracing, we see the 7900 XT pull ahead by a pretty impressive 26%, while at 1440p, the 7900 XT beats the 3080 by around 24%. And finally at 1080p, we see that drop a little, with the pulling ahead by only 14%. Ray tracing in F122, however, is pretty light compared to Cyberpunk, with only the shadows being ray traced, so it's still counted as a win for the 7900 XT here. Moving along now to Hitman 3, max settings with ray tracing enabled. At 4K, the 7900 XT trails the 3080 by a pretty insignificant 5%, a difference you probably won't be able to tell as it's only about a frame high, while at 1440p, It can only beat it in average frames by around 5%. And lastly, at 1080p, it loses to the 3080 by a few frames or about 3%. Next up is Shadow of the Tomb Raider, and at 4K maximum settings with ray tracing enabled, the 7900 XT pulls ahead by 24%, while at 1440, it ends up beating the 3080 by 27%. And finally, at 1080p, we see the 7900 XT lead by 25%. Shadow of the Tomb Raider, like F1, does not have full ray tracing, and only uses it for slightly enhanced shadow effects. Last but not least for gaming today, in Spider-Man Remastered 4K, you know all the rest, the 7900 XT interestingly leads by around 27%, while at 1440p, that swings, pun intended, to around 33% increase versus the 3080. And lastly, at 1080p, we interestingly see no difference between these cards at this resolution, probably because we're becoming CPU bound. To summarize all the ray tracing games we've tested today, at 4K, the 7900 XT is roughly 20% better, while at 1440p, it's around the same, at around 21% better. And finally, at 1080p, it trails the 3080 by 10%. It is better, but once again, it's not nearly anything to write home about. As I previously stated, when it comes to average FPS per dollar, you can take these figures and divide them if the price of one of these cards changes. At 4K, the value between these cards is practically identical. However, at 1440p, the 7900 XT does provide 11% more value as compared to the 3080. However, at 1080p, once again, the value is identical. Now moving along to the average power consumption between these cards, at 4K, the 7900 XT draws 15% more power, while at 1440p, it draws 18% more power, and finally at 1080p, it draws upwards of 21% more power. This leads us to performance per watt while ray tracing, and at 4K, the performance per watt is unsurprisingly at this point identical. However, at 1440p, the 7900 XT does lead a tiny bit by 4%, and at 1080p, the 3080 is more efficient, with the 7900 XT losing by 11%. Moving on to the benchmarks, the 7900 XT outperforms the 3080 by 51%. In 3D Mark Time Spy, which is surprising given the performance we saw in rasterized games. This goes to show that 3D Mark isn't all that realistic, but we'll leave it here for good measure. The gap narrows significantly in Port Royal, which again demonstrates the card's ray tracing capabilities, with the 7900 XT only pulling 25% ahead of the 3080. Moving on to some more real world scenarios, such as the Puget Bench Adobe Suite benchmarks. Starting us off in Premiere Pro, we see the 7900 XT lose to the 3080 by 7%, which isn't something that you'll notice a difference with, but it goes to show that the encoders still aren't as good as Nvidia's. Furthermore, in After Effects, the 7900 XT once again loses to the 3080 by around 0.33%, while interestingly performing a bit better in Photoshop by 15% versus the 3080. To summarize, in Puget Bench, the average across all three Adobe apps was that the 7900 XT performed roughly 4% better than the 3080. So again, no difference to write home about. Taking that average score and calculating performance per dollar, the 7900 XT ends up losing by 8% to the 3080, which means you end up getting less performance for more money spent. Moving along with average power consumption across these same workloads, the 7900 XT ends up drawing upwards of 76% more power than the 3080. And as we get into performance per watt, it's no surprise that the 7900 XT loses to the 3080 in efficiency by a whopping 42%. Moving on to the 7900 XT's overclock, we were able to push the GPU core while in Heaven benchmark up from 2825MHz to 3350MHz, or about a 525MHz clock speed increase, while also pushing the memory from 2500MHz to 2626MHz, or a 126MHz clock speed bump, and finally bumping the power limit to 115%. This did not translate to much more performance, only increasing the average frames while in Heaven by about 4%, or about 9 frames. Pretty poor results considering that this is a pretty insane overclock if you ask me. What it did expedite, however, is the power consumption, which increased the average power draw by 18%, while also increasing the GPU core average temperature by 10%, and additionally increasing the noise levels slightly by 3%. To conclude, the AMD Radeon RX 7900 XT may be a powerful graphics card per se, with pretty decent performance, but it very much falls short of its claims as the most advanced graphics card for gamers and creators. While it may outperform the last-gen NVIDIA RTX 3080 in some games of 4K, the gap between these cards narrows as the resolution decreases, which, as I said, could be a result of the drivers, but AMD has already had plenty of time to sort them out at this point. The 7900 XT also struggles in some ray tracing games, again as compared to the 3080, and even the productivity performance for this card was a bit of a bust, owing to AMD still not having sorted out their encoders. Furthermore, it's steep price, which hasn't dropped since launch, and is only a couple of $100 less expensive than the much more powerful 4080. It makes it difficult to recommend to anyone, especially when compared to even the 3080, which can be found on eBay for a lot less than brand new. Again, we would have liked to compare the 7900 XT to the 3080, and even the 4070 Ti, but again, as I said, the video really wouldn't budge. However, despite its shortcomings, the RX 7900 XT is still a pretty impressive card, and is still pretty viable for gamers who prioritize raw rasterization performance over ray tracing. It just fell short of its hype, and still has a pretty high price tag, which might not make it worth it for some people. Anyways guys, if you like this new format, well, consider giving the video a like then, and subscribe if you want us to review more cards.